In the last few classes, we have been looking at analog to digital converters and digital to analog converters. We know the basic operation and characteristics, and these are also essential parts of any system because you have a DSP core, a digital signal processing core, and to put signals into the core, you need analog to digital converters, and to get signals out of it, you need digital to analog converters. Okay? They also have a lot of other uses. Okay? Essentially, when you want to make digitally programmable anything, you will need these components. Now, we have studied a few architectures in some basic to understand the basic functionality, mainly the two types of A to D converters, the binary search type and the flash type, and also D2A, the digital to analog converters, where you have strings of resistors or some connections of capacitors, usually binary weighted, so that you get all the possible outputs that you want. Okay, so now we will look at some metrics that are commonly used to characterize these digital to analog and analog to digital converters. These two are collectively termed data converters. Okay. And in fact, if you are interested, there is a course that is titled VLSI Data Conversion Circuit Design that deals with exclusively with analog to digital converters and digital to analog converters. Okay. Now, how do we characterize them? We will deal with ADCs and DACs together. ADCs have a voltage input and a digital output, and DACs have a digital input and a voltage output. They also have two other parameters. One is the reference voltage that defines the scale, other is the sampling frequency that decides the sampling rate. Okay, that is once every 1 over FS, once every TS, it takes a sample, converts it to digital and gives you the data. Okay, so ADC does both discretization on the time axis as well as on the amplitude axis. Now, what we have not discussed is like various kinds of codes, that is, we have assumed that Vin is always positive, it goes from, the way we have defined the characteristic, it is like that. And then there are many options for how that is. You could have negative to positive values symmetrically placed or only negative. And similarly, Dout could have, could be in any of the usual digital codes, right? Straight binary or 2's complement or 1's complement or and so on. Okay? We won't discuss that. We will assume that this is just a number, exactly in what binary format it is in, it is not a concern for us right now. Okay. So, now this has of course one more parameter. If you say it is an n bit ADC, this D out has values going from 0 to 2 to the n minus 1. Okay. Similarly, the DAC has VREF, which defines the scale, and a clock at FS. So, this is a clock signal, VREF is a DC signal, it is a reference. So, this clock defines the conversion rate. Okay? That is, Dn will be taken at, let us say, the rising edges of the clock, and you will get an output voltage corresponding to the value of Dn. Okay? And that is known as the conversion rate. So, here it is called the sampling rate, and here it is the conversion rate. And if it is an n bit DAC, Dn can go from 0 to 2 to the n minus 1. Okay. And if you plot the output versus input characteristics, D out versus V in, ideally ADC's characteristic will look like this, okay. It is defined by these transition points, meaning the points at which the output digit switches from one to the next. For convenience of drawing, I will show 3-bit examples, but exactly the same thing applies to any number of bits. No, D out has 2 to the n possible values, okay. What you call them is up to you, right. I mean, for instance, if fancy strikes me, I could call this minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, okay. Or rather, in fact, if I do the other way around, if I slightly shift it, if I do minus 4, minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, that corresponds to some sort of 2's complement code where 0 is somewhere here, right. So, the choice of code is up to you. Basically, you have in a n-bit ADC 2 to the n possible output digits, that is all, right. Exactly what binary code, I mean, you have gray code and so on, and which have some significance in practical implementation, we won't discuss that. A more significant thing is the range of input voltages. In fact, we have not discussed the range, but I will talk about it. For instance, I have assumed that basically the interesting part of the characteristic is all for positive values of Vin. But it could be that this y axis, I could draw it in the middle and then you have both negative and positive, that is possible. And it is not even necessary that the number of output levels be an integer power of 2, okay. You could have a, let us say, 6 level A to D converter. It is not common, but you can have that, right. So, basically the point I was making was that the A to D converter is defined by these transition points, okay. I will call them V1, V2, V3, etc., all the way up to V7, okay. These are what define the A to D converter, right. If you know these 7 values, you can draw the characteristics, okay. For the y axis, you can choose any digit, any distinct digits that you want, that is all. Now, ideally, I mean, in general, of course, you have V1, V2, all the way up to V2 to the n minus 1, okay. And ideally, what is the value of the kth transition point? What should be the value? Yeah. So, k by 2 to the n times V ref. Okay. Is this fine? So, the first one is at 1 by 2 to the n times V ref. And similarly, for a DAC, you would have the output voltage versus the input digit goes from 0 to 7, or in general from 0 to 2 to the n minus 1, and the output voltage, I will define them again with only positive values, can be 0, something here, something there, should be proportional to the input digit. So there are 8 possible output values corresponding to each of the input digit values, and I will call them V0, V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6, V7. Okay. V0 to V2 to the n minus 1. Okay. This is fine. And what should the values be? What should be the value of Vk? K by 2 to the n times V ref. Okay. That definition is exactly the same for both the A to D and the D to A converter. No, it is K by 2 to the n. K runs from 0 to 2 to the n minus 1, right? Okay. And these are the output levels, okay. So, 2 to the n output levels of the D to A converter. And they define the character D to A converter, the digital to analog converter completely, just like the transition points of the A to D converter. Okay. So now we have some metrics for the A to D and D to A converters based on these output levels or transition points. Okay. Firstly, let's look at the A to D converter. So, again I will draw the same characteristic. Well, let me consider a system like this first of all. The output of I have the input Vin applied to an A to D converter, and let us say this has a reference voltage V ref, and the output digit is fed to a D to A converter which also has a reference voltage V ref. Now, this entire thing has a voltage input and a voltage output, okay. And such a thing is known as a quantizer. If I plot the characteristics V out versus V in, what will that look like? We know the characteristics of the A to D, we know the characteristics of the D to A. So, what will this look like? Steps. Yeah, it will look exactly like the characteristics of the A to D, except that I have to relabel the y axis, that is all. Okay. So, this will be 0, the first one will be V ref by 2 to the n and so on, and the last one will be V ref times 2 to the n minus 1 by 2 to the n. Okay. So, here we have a voltage input and a voltage output, and the output voltage is a sort of rounded off approximation to the input voltage. Okay. Is this fine? Now, let me consider the error okay. That is, the output is a voltage. It is approximately equal to the input, but not exactly the same, right. And the error between them I define as V in minus V out of the quantizer. Okay. And let me call that V q, right. So if I plot VQ versus VIN, what will that look like? Please plot it. VQ versus VIN, what will that look like? So clearly, if I plot VIN versus VIN, that looks like this, right? Okay. And that minus the red one, that is what I am looking for. That has jumps at every transition point of the A to D, and that is what it looks like. Is it okay? So the error between the input and output, if you look in the middle of the characteristics, right, it is bounded. That is, if you look somewhere here, it does not go beyond a certain, beyond some value, because as the input increases, the output code will change of the A to D converter. So the output voltage will change and the error falls back to 0. Okay. What is the peak to peak value of the error in the middle of the characteristic? VREF by 2 to the n, okay. So this peak to peak value, this is VREF by 2 to the n. Now as you go far out, what happens is the output digit of the A to D no longer is increasing. So the error will go on increasing, both on the higher side and the lower side, okay. This is fine. Now let me say that I will mark off the range of inputs for which the error remains within this bound VREF by 2 to the n. What is that range? What is the range of inputs for which the peak to peak error remains within VREF by 2 to the n? Huh? 0 to? No, no, that is the x axis is voltage. Zero to VREF times 2 to the n minus 1 by 2 to the n. Is that correct? VREF, right? Because in fact the way the characteristic is drawn, it is very easy to see. This one is VREF by 2 to the n. This last point here is in fact VREF times 2 to the n minus 1 by 2 to the n, okay. And you can go one more step beyond that. So this range is VREF, okay. Is it okay? So in fact that is sort of the definition of the range. So when you have VREF, when you have an A to D converter of reference voltage VREF, what it means is that there is a certain range of width VREF over which the error remains within VREF by 2 to the n, the peak to peak error, okay. So this aspect is independent of how we define the characteristics, whether we include positive voltages or negative voltages or both positive and negative and so on, okay. So basically an A to D converter of reference voltage VREF means that an n bit A to D converter of reference voltage VREF means that over a voltage range of VREF, this quantization error, this error VQ is called the quantization error. The peak to peak value of this remains within VREF by 2 to the n. Again, you can define the characteristics differently. So in this case, if you look at the blue curve, it is always positive, right? But it does not have to be like that. It can be always negative or it can be partially positive and negative. But the peak to peak value will always be VREF by 2 to the n, okay. So that is what we will see. So with this we can define a couple of terms. This Vref by 2 to the n, that is known as, I mean these terminologies sometimes are not used very rigorously. It's the least significant voltage or VLSB of the ADC or DAC. For DAC also it's the same thing, it's the smallest step that you can generate, okay. And Vref is the range of the ADC, and for the DAC it's the same thing, and it's also the range over which the quantization error peak to peak remains within VLSB. Okay. The quantization error makes sense only for the A to D converter, right? Because that's what is taking a continuous valued input and giving a discrete valued output. For the D to A converter, there is no such thing as quantization error because the input is quantized already and the output should be just proportional to it. Okay. Is this okay? So this is how we define the range. Now this is for an ideal converter where all the transition levels are spaced equally, okay. So the distance between transition levels, what is it? The distance between any two successive transition levels, what is that? It is equal to the LSB, the least significant voltage. It is Vref by 2 to the n. And in an ideal A to D converter, all these things are spaced equally, okay, at integer multiples of Vref by 2 to the n, okay. So now based on these we can define, we can see what happens in non-ideal A to D converters, okay. You cannot make anything exactly ideal like this. For instance, if you go back to the flash ADC, right, where what defines the transition points there in the flash ADC? You remember the flash ADC, we have a resistive divider string and the input voltage is compared with every tap voltage of the resistive divider, okay. So is it guaranteed that they will all be exactly like this, that is integer multiples of Vref by 2 to the n? What might cause errors? Yeah, mismatch between different resistors, right. The resistors will not be exactly identical. So the transition levels will not be placed exactly at integer multiples of Vref by 2 to the n, they will move slightly. So that means that we should have a measure of how much it moves, etc. Okay. So that's what we will look at. So in this is the ideal characteristic. In reality the transition points will move, and similarly for a D to A converter, for a digital to analog converter, the output voltage will not be exactly integer multiple of Vref by 2 to the n, it will be something different, okay. So the errors are what we look at. Is okay? So for ADC, these are errors in the transition points. For a DAC, these are errors in the output levels, okay. So first let us assume one thing, that for an A to D, right, V1, the first transition level should be Vref by 2 to the n, and the last one should be Vref times 2 to the n minus 1 by 2 to the n, okay. Let me assume that these two are exactly where they are, okay. Just for simplicity, I will assume that the first transition point and the last one are exactly where they are, okay. Similarly for the DAC, the first output level should be 0, that is corresponding to code 0, and the last one should be the same as in the ADC case. Okay. I'll again assume that these are exactly where they should be, right, at 0 and Vref times 2 to the n minus 1 by 2 to the n. Okay. And the ones in the middle, they can move from the, they could have moved from the ideal values, right. So, based on these, we define two kinds of errors. One is known as the integral nonlinearity error. Okay. And what is this? It is simply the difference between the actual transition level and the ideal transition level. I have assumed that now Vk is not necessarily equal to k by 2 to the n Vref for k between 2 to the n minus 2 and that. Okay. For an ADC and for a DAC, it is between, I mean, the left hand side inequality is from 0. Okay. So, this simply tells you how much the transition level has moved. Is this okay or no? So, remember now Vk is not exactly equal to this. In an ideal A to D converter, this error will be 0, as I mean, in any error definition for the ideal case, the error should go to 0. That is what it does. Okay. So, for an ADC, this k is between 2 and 2 to the n minus 2, and for a DAC, this goes between 1 and 2 to the n minus 2. Some question? This has to be Vref. Thanks. Okay. Now, let me slightly modify this. So, these are the errors in the transition levels k by 2 to the n times Vref, and this has dimensions of voltage. Okay. So, what is done is this is frequently normalized to the ideal LSB. Okay. You understand? So, basically this is normalized to the LSB voltage. So, you get a dimensionless number for the integral nonlinearity error. This is how it is defined. Is this okay? Essentially, what it says is all the transition levels should be separated, I mean, at the integer multiples of 1 LSB, Vref by 2 to the n. This is telling you how much it is displaced, not in terms of voltage, but in terms of LSB itself. Okay. What do you think is a reasonable limit for this? This can be either positive or negative, but what is a reasonable limit? Less than 1 for sure. Any number less than 1 is okay, or half. Typically, I mean, without any, this can be anything. Actually, you will see many A to D converters in which this will also be more than 1. But what can happen is, for instance, so let's say that this transition level here has moved to the right by about half LSB. So, this becomes like that. And the next one has moved to the left by half LSB. Okay. So, then you will see that this particular code does not occur at all, right. So, it will jump from, it will basically skip something. Okay. So, if this error is less than half, then you are guaranteed not to have that situation. Okay. So, that is known as a missing code in an A to D converter. You are guaranteed not to have that situation. The other way is not true. It can be that this is more than half and you still do not have any skips like that, because I assume that first one is moved to the right, the next one is moved to the left. That may not happen, okay? But this is abbreviated to INL, and INL less than, the absolute value of INL less than half is what you would want to have. In absence of any other information, right? This is like 60 degrees phase margin and so on. You know that it results in a good A to D converter, okay? It could be that the error is more than this, and that is quite acceptable for some application or the other. This is okay? And there is a related definition. Which is known as the differential nonlinearity error, okay. And what is that? What should be the step size? Vk minus Vk minus 1. What should be the difference between successive transition points in an A to D converter or successive output voltages in a D to A converter? Vref by 2 to the n, it should be equal to the least significant bit VLSB, right. But it may not be, obviously, if the transition points have moved or the output voltages have moved. So, that the difference between the step and the ideal step normalized to 1 LSB, this is the DNL or differential nonlinearity error, okay. And you can pick up any A to D data sheet. And you will see that this INL and DNL errors will be given, okay. So, again DNL should be in a good converter without qualification should be less than half LSB, okay. That is what you would want to have, because after all, let us say I have a 10 bit A to D converter, it is supposed to have a 10 bit A to D converter should have 1023 transition levels, but I have very large INL or DNL. Okay, and so many levels are skipped, and I have only like 256 distinct outputs. I mean, how is this a 10 bit converter, right? This is an 8 bit converter. So, if this error is much more than half LSB, it is not really the number of bits is not really the number of codes that can come out, right? That basically the you have to round off to a certain number of values, and all those values should be used. Otherwise, what is the point? If the A to D counts as, let us say, 0, 4, and so on, basically you skip every 3 in the middle, you will have 2 fewer bits, right. So, that is how it is, okay. So, if you are guaranteed that, I mean, if you know that your A to D has INL less than half LSB and DNL less than half LSB, you know that it is close to being a true n bit converter, okay. But like I said, like many of the other qualitative criteria, not qualitative, sorry, many other criteria. Depending on the application, you may be able to relax one or both of these things, okay. For that, we need to know more about the context, what signal you are applying, what kind of errors matter. Not every error matters everywhere, okay. Even between INL and DNL, INL matters for some things and DNL matters for some other things, okay. Absolutely, yeah. Sum of errors in DNL is the INL. DNL is the first difference of INL, right? I was going to say that next. So, this INL is a function of INL at the kth code is Vk minus k by 2 to the n times Vref divided by Vref by 2 to the n, and DNL of k is Vk minus Vk minus 1 minus Vref by 2 to the n normalized to that, okay. So, okay. So, what is the question? What is delta of INL k? No, INL is the error. What do you mean by error in INL? Yeah, that is this, right? That is the first difference of INL. Or I didn't understand the question. What are you? So INL is the error. It is the movement of the transition points from the ideal value. If you take the first difference of successive ones, you will get the DNL. Basically, DNL is the, if you think of this staircase characteristic of the A to D, how wide is each step compared to the ideal value of Vref by 2 to the n. That is what DNL is. Okay. Whereas INL is where each step is compared to the ideal level. Okay. And the same for the DAC. In a DAC, a DNL is when you increment the code by 1, how much does the output increase? Okay. It's your, for every code increment, it should increase by the same amount, Vref by 2 to the n, but it will increase by something else. Okay. So it's a DNL is a sort of local criterion, right? Around the code value, how much does it increase? Whereas INL is like a global one. What is the actual output compared to the ideal output, right? For instance, each one could move to the right by a very small amount. So that means a very small DNL. But by the time you get here, the INL could be very large, okay, because it has moved by a lot. Similarly, or DNL can be large, that is, this moves to the right by a large amount, the next one stays the same. So it has a negative DNL, okay. You can have positive DNL, negative DNL, and so on, which add up to actually a small value of INL, that is possible, okay. So that is why, I mean, different applications, I mean, DNL and INL influence different applications differently, yeah. What is the? I can't hear. How do they report? Yeah, you will have a plot of, I will show you tomorrow. So, you will have a plot of INL versus the code and DNL versus the code. Okay. I'm not sure if I have one to show you right now. This is for a DAC, you can see, right? So both are normalized to LSB, and in fact you can see that the INL is going up to 10 LSB and DNL is, has some spiky characteristic and so on. Exactly what these characteristics look like are very much dependent on the implementation, okay? You can see that the DNL is actually very small for a whole bunch of codes, and then suddenly there are spikes, and that is reflected as these jumps in the INL curve. Right, because this is simply the integral or the cumulative accumulation of DNL, okay. Any questions about that? So those are the two characteristics, and then I assume that in an ADC, V1 equals Vref by 2 to the n, and the last one V2 to the n equals Vref times 2 to the n minus 1 by 2 to the n. Now, this is completely arbitrary. There is no reason to assume that these two alone will be ideal, okay. But I didn't want to complicate the definition with messy algebra. This of course will not be equal to these, okay. So in that case, what you do is you make them equal with a linear transformation, okay, right, because you have two constraints. So you define this is your actual ADC, okay, and you define a gain G and an offset V offset. If you understand the principle, you can work out the algebra yourself, okay. This is your actual ADC, and this has V1 to V2 to the n as the transition levels, okay. So now, what is the purpose of these? The purpose of these two is to make the first and the last equal. Okay, in the middle they can be whatever they want. So how do you do that? What I wanted is V ref by 2 to the n plus V offset times G should be equal to V 1. Meaning when this voltage is V ref by 2 to the n, this should be equal to the first transition point. Okay. So then if you think of this as your A to D converter, the first transition point will be at V ref by 2 to the n. Okay. Similarly, of course, there are two variables here, G and V off. So you need the other equation, V ref times 2 to the n minus 1 by 2 to the n plus V offset times G should be V 2 to the n minus 1. These are the actual transition points. So what we have done is to introduce a gain and an offset, basically a linear transformation, so that from this input the first and last transition levels are indeed V ref by 2 to the n and V ref by 2 to the n minus 1 by 2 to the n. Is this okay? So this is an easier way to think about it. So now you have two more sort of errors, this gain and V offset. Okay. So those are also characteristics of the A to D converter. Just like an amplifier has a gain error and an offset error, for instance, you wanted a unity gain amplifier, the gain will not be exactly 1. You know that if the op amp's gain is not infinite, the voltage follower will not have a gain of 1. Or an inverting amplifier of gain minus 1, if the resistors are mismatched, you will not have exactly 1. And it has an offset, for instance, because of op amp's offset. So exactly in a similar way, the A to D converter also has an offset. And what is the offset and the gain of an A to D converter? This is the definition, right? You make the gain and offset are basically the parameters of the linear transformation, which make the first and last points ideal. Okay. Now I have been referring to A to D converters. For D to A converters, you just substitute this V 1 by V 0. That's all. Okay. V 1 by V 0, and this one will be 0. Is that okay? So now essentially we have, what should be the ideal value of the gain? If the actual ADC was in fact ideal, what would be the value of the gain? 1. And what's the value of offset? 0, as you expect, right? You have gain, offset, and the offset also, instead of specifying V off, it could be normalized to VLSB. Okay, typically in data converter world, that's what you do. You normalize everything to the intended LSB. Okay, so these can be defined for every A to D converter, and you can pick up an A to D converter data sheet, and you will see all of these. Is this fine? Yeah, yeah. We have by 2 to the n, but you calculate the INL and DNL based on the transition levels here, okay, because you have made the first and last the same. So everything I said up earlier will apply, right? You look at the transition points referred to this input, okay. The first one of course will be at V ref by 2 to the n. Then this, when this becomes equal to V 2, the actual transition point here, you have to find out what this input is, okay, through the use of gain and offset. And that will give you the second transition level. Okay. So this what is inside the red box is a new A to D converter whose first transition point is at V ref by 2 to the n. The last one is at V ref by 2 to the n minus 1 by 2 to the n, meaning these two are at their ideal levels. Okay. And the remaining you have to calculate based on the actual transition levels here and the value of G and the value of offset. Okay. And from those transition levels you calculate the INL and DNL. Okay. Any questions here? And INL and DNL are actually related, right? It's enough to specify one of them. One is determined uniquely from the other. If you specify INL, you can get the DNL. But because you can have large DNL and small INL and vice versa, different applications are influenced by INL and DNL differently. So you invariably specify both of them. Any questions about any aspect of data converters? this part now refers only to the ADC, okay? Because you can see, right, ADC does the round off, okay? It does quantization, it takes a continuous set of input values and maps it to discrete. DAC doesn't do that. For DAC, the input itself is discrete and the output should be proportional to this. The errors in a DAC are basically deviation from that proportionality. The output voltage should be proportional to the input digit. If it's not proportional, that's an error. And this INL, DNL and gain error and offset error are the quantities that describe that error, okay? For an ADC, there is also this question of how well it rounds off the input. So again, we will take this ADC and ideal DAC combination. I have a voltage input and a voltage output. And if the ADC itself is ideal, I will assume also an ideal ADC. We have already drawn the characteristics, right? V out, V in. The ADC characteristics are like this. Okay, and the quantization error versus V in is like that, and the range of the A to D converter is V ref. Okay. So, another way of characterizing an A to D converter is to apply a signal whose full scale is V ref and see, I mean, if the A to D converter had infinite precision, the output should be exactly the same as the input, right? I mean, in this case, you imagine that both ADC and DAC have infinite precision. That means that basically they are not really quantizing at all, they are simply giving out the input, then the output should be exactly the same as the input. So, now what we do is we apply some signal which spans this range of V ref and look at the error signal V q, okay, and look at the energy in V q normalized to the energy in the signal, okay. So, that is another measure of ADCs. Is it okay? So, now I mean there is some this quantization error, because it is a highly nonlinear characteristics, right? You can see this jagged sawtooth. So, if you apply a random signal, you have to calculate the probability distribution function of density function of the error and so on and calculate it. But I will take a simpler way and show you, it will give you the right result, okay. First, what I do is here, this is the time axis, and let us say I apply a triangular wave, okay, that goes from 0 to V ref. Basically, it spans this, okay. This is my input voltage. And this is very slow, that is let me just assume that it is very slow and so on. Actually, it does not matter, but anyway, that's what it is. Now, what will VQ look like? VQ, this is VQ, right, the quantization error. For this, I want to, on the same time axis, I want to plot VQ, that is V in minus, or let me plot V out of the quantizer. What will that look like? It will have the same exact same staircase, right? So, maybe I should have drawn it to a better scale. So, approximately this is where V ref would be, that's what it'll look like.
Sorry, it's like this here.
And it jumps. Some staircase approximation to the triangular wave. What is the difference between the two? Do I have one fewer step than? I think I have probably 7 instead of 8, but you get the idea. Okay. So, what will the quantization error look like? Huh? So, it will be this sawtooth, right? It will be exactly this sawtooth. Okay. Then here it will do something like that, and then the slope reverses and so on. Okay. What is the average value of VQ? Yeah, it is half of VLSB, right? Because this is a positive, but it's a linear this thing, so the average value will be half of that. Okay. Right. So, this VQ is a sawtooth wave, and then sometimes it reverses slope, but basically it is a sawtooth wave. We can just assume that it is a sawtooth wave. Right. Now, first of all, what is the, you have this triangular wave whose peak to peak value is Vref. Okay. So, what is the energy in this, or what is the mean square value of this, or root mean square value of this? Vref? Now, let us take the mean square value. How much is that? What is it? No. The peak to peak value is Vref. What is it that you are remembering? Vref square by 3. What is the result? Where did the result come from? Energy of what? So, you are familiar with the, okay, maybe I should also modify the question. So, yeah, you are right, but what I was thinking of was after the average is subtracted. Okay. So, what is the average of the input signal? If it is a triangular wave, what is the average value? Vref by 2. Okay. So, if you subtract off the average, because it is just like a DC offset, you will have a 0 average signal. What is the peak value? Vref by 2. Okay. So, what is the RMS value of this, or the mean square value of this? What is the RMS value? What is the RMS value of a triangular wave with a given peak? V peak by root 3. So, here it is. Vref by 2 square root 3. Okay. So, I forgot to say that we should subtract off the average, because that does not significant. We will just remove the DC part of it, right. And this sawtooth stuff, what is the average value of that? I mean, sawtooth after subtracting the average. Forget the fact that it is reversing the slope. What is the average value of a sawtooth? The sawtooth wave was like that. What would be the average value? Where this is VLSB, right? The peak to peak value is VLSB. So, what is the peak value? Half of VLSB. So, what is the RMS value of a sawtooth wave? What is it? Same as the triangular wave, right? So, the RMS value of this is VLS by 2 square root 3. Okay? Understand? Okay, I forgot to mention that we have to subtract off the averages. So, if you feed in a triangular wave to an ideal A to D converter, ideal quantizer, that is ideal A to D followed by an ideal DAC. The output will be a staircase approximation to a triangle, okay, and the quantization error will be some sort of sawtooth waveform, okay. This reverses slopes in some places, but let us ignore that part. Actually, if you calculate it, the result will be exactly the same. So, the quantization error has an average value of half LSB and a peak to peak value of VLSB, okay. I will remove the average value and calculate the RMS value, which is like a measure of energy in the quantization error. That is VLSB by 2 square root 3. Is that okay? Is that fine, that calculation? Similarly, the input is a triangular wave, I will remove the average. The average comes about because I have defined the A to D characteristics on only the positive V axis, right. If I had it centered at 0, the average would be automatically 0, okay. So, I will remove the average, that is not significant, right. So, the RMS value of the triangular wave is Vref by 2 square root 3, okay. So, this is like the signal and this is like the noise. I mean, this is not random noise or thermal noise that you would have in resistors, but this is quantization noise. It should be properly called the quantization error, okay. And you heard the term signal to noise ratio, right? Where? In what context is that? Where do you hear of the term signal to noise ratio? Have you heard of it or not? If it is not, it is fine, but it is a measure that is also commonly used and particularly in communication systems, right. The received signal will have some signal to noise ratio and so on. So, that decides the probability of errors, etcetera. So, signal to noise ratio or signal to error ratio, the ratio of signal energy to error energy is a common way of characterizing many things, okay. And that is what we will do. We will calculate S by N. And this is typically expressed in dB. So, I should take 20 log if these are RMS values. If these are mean square values, I should take 10 log, okay. And how much is that? Let me call it signal and noise. How much is that? How much is it? How much is the ratio of signal to noise, RMS values? 2 to the? Yeah, that is all. It is Vref by VLSB, right? That is 2 to the n. So, it is 20 log 10, 2 to the n or 6.02 n because log 2, 20 log 2 is 6, right? Where n is the number of bits. Is this okay? So, if you feed a triangular wave whose peak to peak equals the range of the A to D converter to an ideal quantizer, the signal to error ratio will be 6n and this of course the units are dB. That is, if you have a 10 bit A to D converter, you will get 60 dB of signal to noise ratio, okay. Is this fine? Now, of course, we do not do these tests with a triangular wave. We always do things with a sine wave. It is easier to generate because if you, even if you manage to generate a triangular wave, by the time you feed it to the A to D converter because of parasitic resistors and capacitors all over the place, it will no longer look like a triangular wave. But a sine wave will still look like a sine wave, okay. So, now instead of a triangular wave, we will apply a sine wave. And this sawtooth wave will look slightly different. It will have different slopes at different points. But again, I won't prove it. It turns out that the RMS value of the sawtooth remains the same, okay, because those steps are so small that it remains the same. We don't have to worry about that part. That's why I started with a triangular wave, because if I started with a sine wave or some other random signal, I would have to go into the distribution of the quantization error and so on. I didn't want to do that. So, it turns out that the RMS value of the quantization error will be exactly the same. What is the RMS value of the signal in this case? VRF by? VRF by 2 root 2, that's all. Okay. So, what will be the signal to noise ratio? That is 20 log of signal RMS by noise RMS. What additional thing do we have here? 2 to the n times square root of 3 by 2. How much is that? How much is square root 3 by 2? One point? No. Ten log 3 minus 10 log 2. How much is log 3? Have you heard of log tables? Okay. 0.48. Yeah. And then what is log 2? 0.3. So what is 10 log? 1.8. Okay. So it is 6.0 to n plus 1.8 dB. Okay. So, you do this test with a sine wave, and if you do it for an ideal quantizer, this is what you would get, right. So, let us say you had a 10 bit A to D converter, so if you have a 10 bit ADC with a VREF of 1 volt and you apply a sine wave with a peak to peak voltage of 1 volt, you will get an SNR of how much? 61.8 dB, right, or 62 dB probably, okay, because it is 6.02 and then, okay. To summarize, the signal to noise ratio of an ADC is another measure of how good the ADC is. We discussed other measures like differential nonlinearity and integral nonlinearity. This is another measure. So, this is based on the idea that if you have an n bit quantizer with a full scale or reference voltage of VREF, then if you apply a triangular wave of peak to peak value equals VREF, what happens is that the quantization error is a sawtooth wave and whose peak to peak value is how much? What is the peak to peak value of the quantization error? VREF by 2 to the n, VLSB basically. Now, the RMS value of this after removing DC, this is VREF by 2 square root 3. And the RMS value of this again after removing DC is VREF by 2 to the n times 2 square root 3, because for the same peak value the sawtooth and the triangular wave have the same RMS values, right. So, the ratio of these two, which is the SNR typically expressed in dB, this is 6n. Okay. So, for every bit you have 6 dB increase in the signal to noise ratio. This makes sense, right? For a given reference voltage, essentially if you increase the number of bits, the round off error will be half as much. So, the noise will be half as much or 6 dB smaller. Now, of course, this I showed you just so that the calculations become easier, the quantization error is a sawtooth wave. In reality, we do this test with a sine wave, okay. Like most other things, we test our circuits with a sine wave. Now, if you have a sine wave of peak to peak value Vref, the quantization error is some distorted sawtooth wave, but it turns out that the RMS value is about the peak to peak value is of course Vref by 2 to the n, okay. So, this is correct, and the RMS value of the sine wave after removing DC is 2 square root 2, okay, it is higher than the triangular wave. That makes sense, right, because for the same peak the sine wave looks like, the square triangular wave looks like that and the sine wave looks like that. Sine wave is higher than the triangular wave everywhere, so it has to have higher RMS value. And this part is what I assumed from the previous one, the RMS value of the quantization error, even if it is a distorted sawtooth wave, the RMS value will be close to this, so we assume that that is the case. So, in this case we get a slightly different result, okay. So, we get an additional factor of square root 3 by 2 which gives you 6.02 n plus 1.8 dB, okay. So, what this means is if you take an analog to digital converter with a 1 volt full scale ideal A to D converter and apply a 1 volt peak to peak sinusoid to it and measure the output signal to noise ratio. Signal means the component at the input frequency, because the output is discrete time, right. So, you can look at the spectrum of the discrete time signal, look at the component at the frequency of the sinusoid, you will get something, and you will also get a number of components at other frequencies, that is the error, okay. So, the energy in the signal to the energy in the error, if you calculate in dB, you should get it to be 6 n plus 1.8, okay. So, if you put some numbers, if you say you have a 10 bit ADC and if you have a 1 volt Vref, then you drive it with a sinusoid whose peak value is half a volt, right, so that the peak to peak is 1 volt, then the output SNR will be basically 60.2 plus 1.8, 62 dB, right. This is what an ideal 10 bit ADC will give you, but if you take a real ADC, what do you think will happen to the SNR? It will be smaller, I mean there is no magic which will give you higher signal to noise ratio, right. So, it will be smaller. So, what you do is you use the SNR itself to characterize it. So, let us say it is nominally 10 bits, nominally n bits, okay. Meaning for instance, you could have a SAR ADC which goes through 10 steps to resolve it to 10 bits and you measure the SNR with sinusoid of peak to peak value equals Vref. Exactly how to measure it needs some more detailed discussion, we would not go into it, but you get the idea. You look at the full scale of the ADC, you apply a sinusoid equal to that and let us say what you get is some SNR prime, okay. Now this will be less than 6.02 n plus 1.8 dB. So this itself can be used to characterize it, and you can also define an effective number of bits based on the calculated SNR. Okay, meaning you make this SNR prime equals 6.0 times some other n effective plus 1.8 dB. So n effective will be SNR prime minus 1.8 divided by 6.02. So for instance, let's say you make a what you think is a 10 bit ADC. You measure the SNR like this, and you get an SNR of 55 dB. Okay, so what do you have? So 55, or maybe let's make it 56 dB. 56 minus 1.8 dB divided by 6.02. I will say that this is approximately 54. So this is 9 bits. Okay, you made a 10 bit converter, but it's actually resolving only to a 9 bit accuracy. Okay, so that's what it means. So that is another metric to characterize analog to digital converters. Okay, so we have INL, DNL, offset and gain errors, plus you also have the signal to noise ratio and the effective number of bits. Okay, these are what we use to characterize ADCs, and if you look at an ADC data sheet, you will see these things. Okay, like the plot I showed yesterday, the plot of INL, DNL versus the input code, the maximum signal to noise ratio that you can get, and so on. Okay, any questions about any aspect of this, of ADCs or DACs? So that brings us to end of the topics that we wanted to discuss.